Long time no see. So I've been busy with a lot of stuff in my personal life, and I've also been thinking about how the what these large language models mean for the future of programming. Because it's clear that they are very good already, and they're only becoming better. But I think that still the quality that you get out of using a large language model to program is proportional to your own skill as a programmer. So at the current stage, it still makes sense to be really good at programming. And then you will use large language models to multiply your output. But you still need to understand programming. You still need to understand how to write good programs and how to decompose problems into smaller parts and how to structure a program, how to test it, and things like that. You may be a lot of the time with large language models working at a higher level of abstraction than you normally would be in a programming language, but you still have to be a programmer. Now, maybe one day there will be a time where we don't need programmers anymore, but I think that even if that happens, I will still be programming. Kind of similar to how people play chess or solve Sudokus or do crossword puzzles. For fun, I think I'll still do programming as kind of like a some mental gymnastics. So what I hope we can do on this channel is to continue learning together. And today I want to take a look at prat parsing. So we've built programming languages on this channel before, but we use something called recursive descent parsing, which I think is kind of easy to understand. If you write out the grammar of a language, then it's kind of one-to-one with the recursive descent implementation. But a lot of people are saying that prat parsing is better, for example, Jonathan Blow. And it's more optimal in some sense than recursive descent parsing, I think. So to kind of try to understand this better, we'll be looking at this article. And we'll try to implement a small parser. I'm going to be using Sig for this. I am using version 14, 0.14 from the master branch, which you can find here, siglang.org. I will put a link to all of this. We got the documentation open. We got the, sorry, this is the language reference, even though it's just documentation. And this is the docs. We have Claude ready to go if we need that. But let's jump right into it. All right, so it's about prat parsing. There's apparently a huge number of articles on prat parsing, but I'm not gonna get into that. This is the one I found through some video, I think. And we are going to be looking at left recursion, which is something that's kind of difficult to handle, or supposedly difficult to handle in recursive descent parsers, and talk about infix notation. And this is where it gets interesting. There'll be a description implementation of prat parsing algorithm, which sticks to the core and doesn't introduce a DSLe abstraction. And we'll try to understand the algorithm. He writes he's implemented a production grade parser once, but he doesn't understand the code anymore. That's amazing. So assume some familiarity with parsing technique. I think we have that a little bit, but anyway, I think we can work through it, even if we forgot it. Doesn't explain what a context-free grammar is. I don't think we need to know the formal definition of this, but I think we'll get through it. So, why don't we just start by making a, let's call it sig prat, why not? So go in here and we'll be making a main, and you have to import it like this, and we have to make a main function which can error. I think that's kind of required. And then we can say std debug, yes, debug print. And I think we also need kind of like this stuff, and then we can say sig run main sig, compiles it and says hello world. All right, I don't think we need a build script right now, so let's just stick to this. Anyway, so parsing is a process by which a compiler turns a sequence of tokens into a tree representation. So we also kind of need a tokenizer. We'll think about that. So there are many approaches to this task, which roughly falls into one of the two categories, using a DSL to specify the abstract grammar of the language, handwriting the parser. Okay, byte parsing is by handwritten parsers. We like that because we can optimize this. We can actually understand what's going on. But maybe looking at one of those automatic parse generators would be interesting in a future video. So this BNF is, I forget exactly what it stands for, but it is a way of specifying what kind of expressions are allowed in the language. The pinnacle of syntactic analysis theory is discovering the context-free grammar notation for decoding linear structures into trees. So here is an example. An expression can be an expression plus, so the literal plus, and another expression. Or it can be an expression times an expression, or it can be parenthesis, expression parenthesis, or it can be a number. So you can see here that this kind of falls into that category. We have an expression, which is a number. Then we have a plus, so we are matching kind of this one. Then we have another expression. That expression is an expression, which is a number. It's a times, and it's another expression, which is also a number. I'll just skip that. I remember being fascinated by this idea, especially parallels with natural language sentence structure. So we already talked about this. Although this grammar looks great, it's in fact ambiguous and imprecise. So one thing that's ambiguous about this is that you don't know whether this should be 1 plus 2 times 3 or 1 plus 2 times 3. We kind of know what we want, but it's not clear from this this way of writing it down. So it needs to be rewritten to be amenable to automated parser generation. Specifically, we need to specify precedence, and exactly what I was talking about. The fixed grammar looks like this. So now an expression is a factor. This is kind of what we use for recursive descent. So because factor is kind of like lower down in this list of expressions, it's kind of has a higher precedence. To me, the shape of expressions feels completely lost in this new formulation. Moreover, it took me 3 or 4 courses in formal language before I was able to reliably create this grammar myself. It's kind of interesting. I think the Crafting Interpreters book does a really good job of explaining it. And just reading that kind of made a click for me. That's why I love pred parsing. It's an enhancement of recursive descent parsing algorithm which uses the natural terminology of precedence and associativity parsing expressions instead of grammar obfuscation techniques. I don't think it's an obfuscation, but whatever. Recursive descent and left recursion. The simplest technique for writing a parser is recursive descent, which models the grammar as a set of mutually recursive functions. For example, the above item grammar fragment can look like this. So, for example, here we would say actually a little bit confused by this, but you'd kind of like pass a factor, and then you would see, is there a plus? And then you would pass another factor, and then you just continue doing that. And then when you pass a factor, you would say try to pass an atom, and if there's a multiplication, then you pass another atom, and so on. And when you try to pass an atom, you will pass a number, or you will look for a parenthesis, and then you will pass a full expression, so it kind of goes back to the top. So he has this item thing where it's a struct item and a num item, and a struct item has a struct keyword in front, it has some kind of name, and then it has brackets some fields and brackets. So that looks like this. When you pass an item, you kind of see, do we get a struct keyword, or do we get an enum keyword? And if it's a struct, we just pass a struct, and so on. And in the struct, you say, take the struct keyword, then get the name, then you expect the left curly, then you get the field this, then you expect the right curly bracket. All right. Textbook points out left recursive grammars as the Achilles heel of this approach, but you don't really, it's not that difficult, I think. But he will talk about that. So indeed, if we naively code the sum function, it wouldn't be too useful. Sum, then if you could just code it like this, you would go back into the sum, it would be like infinite recursion, I suppose. So a theoretical fix to the problem was rewriting grammar to eliminate left recursion. Yeah, we can do that. But in practice, the solution is much simpler, breaking away from with a pure recursive paradigm, exactly, and using a loop. So to pass this, you would say pass an int, look for a plus, and then pass another int, and just keep going like that. Because this can be written out as int plus int plus int plus int. All right. Bread passing the general shape using just loops won't be enough for passing infix expressions. Yes, but that's also what recursive descent does, I would say. Anyway, pred passing uses both loops and recursion. Not only does it send your mind into a Mobius-shaped hamster wheel, but it also handles associativity and precedence. Yeah. I have a confession to make. I'm always confused by high precedence, low precedence. So he just doesn't like talking about high and low. He likes to talk about binding power, which is fine. What about associativity too, though? All operators have the same power. It's unclear which plus to fall first. Okay, I never really thought so much about this, so this is interesting. But this can be modeled with power if we make it slightly asymmetric. So he's kind of saying that you can say an operator has a power to the left and right. So that's interesting. Here the first and only the first plus holds both of its arguments tighter than the neighbors, so we can reduce it. Okay. This seems very like weird, and there's like a special case in the first instance, let's not worry about that right now. Now we can fold the second plus and guess on terms of the syntax tree. The second plus really likes its tight operand more than left one and rushes to get a hold of C. What pred passing does is that it finds these better, stronger than neighbors operators by processing the string from left to right. We're almost at a point where we finally start writing some code. But let's first look at the other running example. We will use function composition operator dot as the right associative operator with a higher binding power. So FGH doing function composition, he says it's right associative, so we need to put the brackets around the right, kind of like eating things from the right. And then he has this weird asymmetric thing. It's kind of weird that, so this one, even though it's exactly the same, like just you change the numbers and you change the symbols, this one he wants to pass as A plus B plus C, and this one he wants to kind of pass as A plus B plus C. So it's kind of inconsistent, and I think this is not a good way to think about it. Okay, we will be passing expressions where basic atoms are single character numbers and variables, and we choose punctuation for operators. That is interesting. So he's obviously using Rust. What exactly does he mean by punctuation? Probably it's just like special characters like this. I don't know if this is technically called punctuation, but let's not be too pedantic. So really to get like a full small language, we'd also have to write a tokenizer. Maybe we can kind of skip that for now, but let's go ahead and write some code. So let me zoom in a bit so it's easier to see. And let's try to learn SIG. So the equivalent of an enum in SIG is something called a tagged union. So let's make that kind of thing. So let's say it's a union and it's going to be tagged by an enum. And we can say, kind of forget exactly how you write it, but I think it's like this. He says it's a character, but we don't really want that. I think we want a full U8 slice. So we can make it const. I think it's like this. And we can have an operator. An operator probably takes an operator type. I think that's nice to have like a separate thing that is an operator type. We can have like a plus, star, minus to begin with. And end of file. I'm not really going to use this. So I don't really know SIG. Let's see if it compiles. Doesn't compile. Error expected. This thing. So maybe I need to do struct. Okay, so here is where we'll turn to the documentation. Let's see. So language reference. And there should be something on unions. So exactly. So we will also zoom in here. Okay, it's simply because, or probably because I need to do this. Could that be it? Okay, so that compiles. Let's just check it out. Complex type tag, but this should also be just this one. So yeah, this is the one I'm using. So variant uses lowercase letters. I guess we can do that. I don't know. Let's use uppercase. I kind of want to kind of feel like doing that. All right. So can we make a token? We can make an atom. It says hello world, and can we print it? How does that work? I think you can say any, and then you can say token, and that did not work. And why did that not work? Yeah, it's because it has this kind of weird syntax where you have to say, okay, the atom part of the union is like that, and like that. Okay, so that works. You can see it doesn't print it very nicely. So maybe we'll define a function that's like print token. So it takes a token reference. And I'm just going to use Copilot for this because there is no real reason. What do we call this? I kind of think we need to call this field something. Maybe is it just dot zero? Is that how we access it? Like that? Can I format it? Didn't seem to work. Let's try to format it like this. It's so weird to me that if you call format sig format, it has to compile stuff. Okay, so it doesn't like that. Let's go back to the documentation. So we have switch, token, and it doesn't really have this case stuff. So let's remove that. And it doesn't have the colon. And let's get rid of that. And here it needs that. And still this is kind of wrong, so we'll delete that. We'll go here, we'll say like that, and then we'll say go to the next case. And that's our macro. We can repeat that, and there we go. Okay. So we have that. Now let's try to call it. So we print the token, get rid of this function. That doesn't work. Cast declare the discards const. So we can, is it like that, a const reference? Maybe can I just do this? I think that kind of automatically makes a reference. Yeah, so now the problem is just here, this stuff. And what is the problem? Invalid format string. Let's try with any again, just to make it run. Okay, so that isn't, if I do std debug print, can't I do s and then say hello string? Yeah, so I can do that. So just now I need a way to get this out. I'm just gonna try something to see if it works. Right, now I cannot initialize it like that. Now I have to say this string is equal to that. It still prints it, because I said any, so we have to say it's actually a string. Now it works. But I could have sworn there was a way to have anonymous fields. So we go up here and we look at struct, so anonymous struct literals. That's just the normal one, right? Actually, let's not spend too much time on this. Maybe we don't call it string, maybe we call it let's call it str, like that. Can we now format it? Doesn't seem like it. I don't understand why it's not working. Okay, it is what it is. So let's just run it again. Here we go. Let's get rid of this. So now we have these tokens. So now we can make a small program. We can say const, let's say program. And let's try to replicate this kind of like 1 plus 2 times 3 program. So how do we do that? I think we have to say, like, how do you do arrays in this crazy language? Arrays. Okay, you need a type somewhere. So this is a type, an array of tokens, and I think this means that it has to calculate the size itself. And the first one is going to be, yeah, so we can use Copilot to do that. Let's unable to infer array size. That's interesting. What if I put it here? Yeah, and now it's just an unused constant, so which is an error in SIG. Not sure how I feel about that, but it's okay. All right. So maybe we have here, like, new line is a boolean. And let's go ahead. Let's go ahead and remove that. And then here, if new line, we'll do this. Don't know why it indented it like that. And this one will be true. And then we can say a for. We can kind of loop over things like this. For each token in there, let's print without a new line, and then the end will print a new line. Okay. So we cannot shadow it in the loop. So let's just say it for now. Okay, and there you have it. So 1 plus 2 times 3. Get rid of that one. All right. Let's go back to the article. So now we have this token implemented, and there is Alexa, which has some tokens. And what is the point of this? We'll be passing expressions where basic atoms are single characters, number of variables, use punctuation. Okay, so he's actually building a tokenizer. Maybe we should just do that. We're already this far. So let's try to, because we can kind of do things that are very similar to this. So you can say, here I have a struct. That struct needs some tokens. It's an array of tokens. We can also give it a function. We can give it like new. And it takes some input, which is a string like that. I suppose it could error, but for now, let's just return the Alexa. And I think we're going to split on white space. And how do we make the tokens? Can I have to allocate them? So I guess we have to take an allocator as well. So that means we need to say, like that. I import that. We have an allocator, and here is this. What is this? That's a good question. Maybe we can get Copilot to say, what is this type? It's a slice of token. Which is fine. Can we have dynamically allocated slices? So if we search on slice, difference between an array and a slice is that array's length is part of the type and not a compile time. Okay, so we cannot use an array. The slice's length is known at runtime. Okay, so that is all right. I think that's what we want. maybe. Let's actually use an array list instead. So array list. Yeah. So this is going to be instead an array list of tokens. It's kind of like a dynamically sized array. So, and it needs an allocator to make one. So we're going to say tokens is an array list that we initialize with this allocator. And then we are going to loop through this string. Every time we meet a space, we are going to say that's a token. Then we have to check sorry, my brain is on vacation. So we loop through the string. We collect everything that's not a white space. Every time we hit a white space, we have like a substring. We have to check if that substring is an operator. If it's an operator, then we make an operator, of course, operator token. If it's not, we make an atom token. So maybe we'll make a pointer. We will make a collecting token. It will start out as false. And then we'll say while pointer is less than input length. Then we'll do some stuff. And it finally will return Alexa where the tokens is this stuff. Can we build this? We cannot because it requires this thing. Expected type expression, line 32. Right, so probably doesn't need this. Just try const for now. Okay, you know what? So, if the input pointer is not equal to a space, then, so if, let's say, not collecting token, that means we're kind of trying to skip white space. And then we're going to check, okay, if it's no longer a white space, then we actually are collecting token. So if we are collecting a token, so actually when we stop this, we should also say token start is somewhere. So token start has to be assigned to the pointer. And here we are collecting token. Let's say once we see a white space, we stop collecting and construct a new token, right? So now we actually kind of have to do the opposite thing. So if we see a white space, then we have to stop collecting a token, right? So that's going to be false. And then the token substring, so token substring is going to be the input from the start to the pointer, and I think it doesn't include let's actually maximize this because it's getting a little bit annoying. So I think it doesn't include the end. So this is correct. Now we have to check this check if it's it's an operator. So how are we going to do that? We need to compare the strings. So I think you have to do std mem compare, something like that. Let's look in the documentation. So compare std mem compare. Pretty sure it's CMP. Okay, let's just search for compare. Has mem equals. Actually, let's try to do this before we do anything crazy. Here we'll say debug print it's a plus. Okay, we are kind of modifying all this stuff now. We are not modifying the token, so it's definitely kind of plain about that. Let's make it const for now, and then we can try to make a new Lexa. Should be Lexa new, and get some kind of heap allocator. So how do we get an allocator? Seek as a general purpose allocator available to be imported with std heap general purpose allocator arena allocator. Let me just see the full. Okay, general purpose allocator. Okay, here's an example. Yeah, you kind of have to call. I don't really understand what the hell is going on here. But let's try to say that our allocator is std heap general purpose allocator. And let's see if that works. We have to say it's okay not to use it. Error, cannot compare strings with equals. It would be nice if it told us what we could use, but I guess no language is perfect. So let's try this one. So we're comparing U8s, and we want to compare the token substring to that thing. Is that a thing? Right, so actually we should remember to say pointer plus equals one. No module name mem is isn't this also std.mem? How was it? Dot allocator. Let's try that. All right, so unfortunately I had an accident where I kind of lost half of the footage I had recorded. And so it's gonna be kind of a weird cut right now that you see. But I hope you can live with that. So I think when the recording stopped working, we were kind of here building the tokenizer. And unfortunately, I kind of made it all the way down to here. So maybe not too much, but like we were, sorry, I'm getting lost in this. We were here and I made it kind of like 3 or 4 code blocks down. So actually there we have a parser now, but let's try to go over how it works. So we're kind of in this if statement, I think, when the recording stopped working. And so let's go over everything from here until the actual parser. So if the input is a white space, we we stop collecting a token. We kind of construct the substring that corresponds to the token. And then we call this function that creates a token from the substring. It's defined down here where it just like checks if the substring is equal to some operator, then it returns an operator, or like it puts an operator into the token array. And if it's an atom, like if it's not an operator, we assume it's an atom and it will put it into, it'll create an atom token and then put it into the tokens array again. Then a more complicated thing would we kind of like probably support identifiers and numbers and so on, but right now we're only supporting numbers. So then we advance the pointer, and at the very end, if we were inside a token, then we also collect that. So we also get the final token, and we return that. So here in the main function, we have an allocator that the Lexer can use to allocate space for its tokens. And then the next step after we lexed, which it does when you call new, is to pass an expression. And that's actually the most interesting part. So when you try to pass something, you always assume that the first thing is an atom. Right? It cannot be an operator like plus or minus, because it doesn't really make sense that that's in the beginning of an expression. So here we kind of get the next thing, which will be the first thing because we're starting the passing, the next token. And if it's an atom, then we just create a new, we allocate a new expression object. Then we put the data into it, which you have to do with this kind of weird syntax in SIG. Then you return that, or you assign that to the left-hand side. This is this kind of like break, labeled break, is the only way I could see to do it. So that's if it's the first one is an atom. If the first one is an operator, we just return an error. So I have my own like custom error type I defined here. You don't really have to do that. I just did. And then what we want to do is consume the rest of the tokens. And first we peek at it. So that means we just look at it. We don't also assume that it has been consumed. And if it's an atom, then that doesn't really work, because you cannot have something like 2, 2. That would be, the first one is an atom, right? But the second one actually has to be an operator. So we get an operator, and then let's look at this one, I guess. So we have now, we have an atom, we have an operator, then we need another thing, right? What is the other thing? Well, it's probably going to be an expression. It's going to have to be an expression, because we can have something like this, you know, where there's arbitrarily many things coming after. But what should that expression be? So suppose we're passing the plus thing. We're passing the plus operation. So it should have, as the left-hand side should be 1, and the right-hand side, if you think about how operator precedence work, should be 2 times 3. So what we want to do when we see an operator and we try to pass the right-hand side, we actually want to pass an expression, but we only want to pass until, like, we only want to consume operators that have a higher precedence than the one we're currently passing. So for example, if it was like this, then we'd see, okay, 1 is the left-hand side, star is the multiplication operator, and then we want to pass an expression until we meet an operator with a lower precedence than multiplication. So we'd call into this function, we'd get 2 for the left-hand side, then we'd see that plus has a lower precedence, so we just return 2. Now, on the other hand, when we have this, we will go in and we'll see there's a 2, there's a multiplication which has a higher precedence, so we keep passing. And then we'll end up with the right thing. So it's based on this concept that, okay, the parser, it really only sees a one, then it sees a plus. You know, this is what it has seen. We know as a kind of, because we wrote it, we know that this is the full full expression from the point of, but from the point of view of the parser, it has only seen one and plus. So now it kind of has to, parser has to remember that it shouldn't parse anything with lower or equal precedence to plus. Okay, so it has to remember that, and then it has to go in and parse as much as it can, which turns out to be 2 times 3 in this case. Then it will return and will continue the construction here, right? So it will return here, and then it will have 1, it will have plus, and it will have 2 times 3. Let me remove that one. So we return here. So here we can say here, parser only knows 1 and plus. And has to remember that whatever is after the plus, it should be everything with a higher precedence than plus. So we kind of group that together into one expression. And then here, once we're done, we have 1 plus 2 times 3. And then we kind of put that into the left-hand side. So before, left-hand side was 1. But now we change it into being this whole thing. You can put parentheses to show explicitly how it's like grouped. And just to say it one more time, like these two times three are grouped because they come from the result of this recursive call to parse expression. So this one will return a binary operation, which is the 2 times 3. Okay, so this is the new left-hand side. And then, okay, because it's a loop, as you can see, it's a while loop, we will go and we will see that the next token is again an operator, right? Because we had passed this stuff, so we are left at a plus. We'll get the plus, and then we'll end up down here, and we'll say pass expression. It will go in and see there's only a 4, so it will return a 4, and then we'll get a left-hand side becomes this. Oh, second time around, it becomes this to this. Then we end up at the end of the while loop. We see that now the current, which is kind of like a pointer to which token we're at, is actually equal to the length of the tokens, so that means we're done, there's no more tokens left, and then we return the left-hand side. So actually, something we can do is to just call this the result. I think that's kind of nice. Like that. It's a little bit too much, but yeah, like this. Let's try to run it again, just to check. And right, there's no thing named result. This one has to be named for left-hand side. Bit of a mistake. Okay. So that is basically how it works. And I'm going to delete this again. I hope the cut is not too abrupt and it kind of makes sense anyway. I also implemented some like helper things like print functions or methods, whatever you want to call it, and something to handle memory management, things like that. But the main thing is this here, the parser. And in the next video, we'll try to add some more complicated stuff like the dot operator function composition, maybe even definitions of functions, and yeah, see what happens. So until next time.